Hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Welcome back to BTS Europe, the first BTS Europe, and we are in the grand final now. It's Navi going against the Fantastic Five. I'm Kyle Guy for Beyond the Summit, and I'm going to be joined remotely by the one and only Scant. Scant, firstly, I want to make sure that your audio and everything is set up and working, and then why don't you fill us in a bit of a roster update here for Navi. Scant, how you doing this morning slash evening for you?
Yeah, evening for me, morning for you. I'm doing all right. Pretty excited. I mean, after yesterday, I crossed the semifinal with Gods where Navi were playing Vega Squadron, and that was a pretty damn exciting semifinal. Mm-hmm. Honestly, we spoke about how like there was potential for that to be more like the grand final because there were two really high profile teams, and it was a very exciting series. The game three, actually, Vega held on against Mega Creeps for a really long time, eventually lost, but this is not the same Navi team today, as you said, because unfortunately, Dendi, for what Navi cited as personal reasons, couldn't make the match today, and so they have Shadow playing in his place today. I'm not sure if that'll affect the role assignment or not. While Fantastic Five is a smaller team in the CIS region, but certainly not an unknown team. BZZ, Yol, and Sadoi played together in Rock's Kiss earlier this year for quite a long time, to quite a large amount of success, actually, and Arctic has been playing, and he played in Ahead Gaming, which was Shoma the Slayer's old team. I don't know as much about Ghostic, but these are not like fresh new names that no one's heard of. I haven't watched them play this tournament. Have you watched them play at all in this tournament? Because they're picking OD.
No, you know, the funny thing is, you know, I got up a little bit extra early this morning just so I can maybe get myself up to speed with Fantastic Five and who they are, how they got here, and some of the members and stuff. And Cyclops has casted all of their games through their run in this tournament. No one else but Cyclops. So I had to watch those VODs to go, you know, see. He didn't really get to offer a whole lot of extra insight on top of Fantastic Five, but they did have an interesting play style. They have a Chen player in Yol, so they have jungling factor there. Obviously, OD, everyone's probably freaking out, you know, new hero on the block, but we got to remember this guy received that little bit of extra sugar lovin' from just that micro patch that came out with what people are anticipating to be a ridiculous buff onto his right click in that arcane orb. So I'm very anxious about that. But as a team and as their players, I haven't really seen enough to see what kind of style. I'm just going to figure it's the traditional Europe/CIS aggressive all out style. So we should be in for some fireworks, but I'm coming in here, Scant, with an open mind. Fantastic Five. Either way, if we get a win here, it should be good. Either Navi may be back, especially without Dendi, or Fantastic Five is going to be the new team on the block to kind of, you know, look over your shoulder at.
Yeah, I mean, look, the good news for Navi is that even though Dendi is the one player who stayed there since, like, how many years ago, this team right now seems to be more and more about Soneko, and to some extent about maybe even art style we saw yesterday. I mean, Ditchera, Axmo definitely doing very well as additions, but Dendi's not really been the centerpiece of the team recently. Yesterday in the one game, Soneko played, it was actually the first game, he played a Sand King, and pretty much the entire game he was the highest net worth on his team. He was making kills left, right, and center, he got a lot of farm. Right at the end of the game, I don't know if you've seen the clip, he got a refresh orb, he four-man stunned, and then refreshed and four-man stunned again. It was just like, he was everything in that game, and that's why they picked it in the first phase here, because for the rest of that series, Vega kept banning the Sand King, so Navi are like, okay, fine, you respect our Sand King, we respect our Sand King, we're going to take it early on.
Mirana even coming out here is the fourth grab for Navi, so already a couple of fresh faces in this one, and I did catch those moments in particular. I know Gods was very giddy about it, and I wanted to make sure I did it justice and went back and checked it out, and it was worth it. So Nico's Sand King play was very exciting, and I'm excited to watch it here in the grand final once again. And, you know, also worth a note for going, I want to go back a page to Fantastic Five. They are a big Oracle playing team, so we'll probably see it banned throughout this whole grand final. Breaks my heart. I love seeing him in play, especially in the hands of people who know what they're doing with it. So we might miss that kind of opportunity unless Navi does decide to sleep on it. Now moving forward, Fantastic Five with their fourth pickup here. They've already committed pretty hard for where they're going with their cores now. You got what is obvious your four position roaming Tusk. Maybe not. Could be also their off lane. OD mid lane, Jug safe lane here. It's time to round it out with some, you know, safe supports. Are we looking to still possibly reach back for something like a Dazzle, or do you think it could be too greedy to still commit for something like a jungler. Like they, like I said before, they did go Chen. Is that too greedy?
I think it pretty is too greedy because you're against the Ban Morana combo. And one of the best ways to deal with the Ban Morana combo, especially if, I mean, they're not sure if Morana could be roaming or what, but to deal with that combo, you need to have multiple heroes in every lane as much as possible. Because if one hero is alone and they get Nightmared and arrowed, they're dead. Compared to if there's a hero nearby, the Nightmare, you could just block the arrow. Mm-hmm. And or you could just save the person once they get arrowed. So I think that to pick a jungler wouldn't really work. And they do go for the Dazzle. It makes a lot of sense. It's a good way to actually protect people from that combo. In fact, the Odie and the Tusk can also protect people. Put someone inside inside your Snowball or just defensively banish them. And the Juggernaut as well. I feel like the interaction, the way it works, I think Juggernaut might actually... No. I think that's the Shadow Demon. The Juggernaut gets the spin-off. I think with the Bane, you should be able to get the arrow regardless during the Nightmare. But yeah, something I was saying about Na'Vi yesterday throughout their series is that there does seem to be an element of cheese to most of their drafts. Two things in common. The one is the Zeus, which seems to come... Yesterday was picked in every game, not always by the same team. And then the other thing is that they seem to be relying somewhat on cheesy draft tactics. And what do you know? I mean, like, OG used a lot of those and won the Frankfurt Major. There's nothing, it's not necessarily wrong to use the cheesy tactics, but Morana and Bane is one of the most classic ones that exists. And
yeah.
So I guess they're sticking to their guns.
Yeah, it's very cheesy. I want to say it's the first time I've seen it in this recent patch, but I know I've seen it once before. It didn't take off to a whole lot of success, but it is something that we have seen from time to time, that those bits of old cheese, if you will, where teams are just maybe flipping the pages back a bit on old patches to see if maybe something is kind of going to be just as good as it once was now that they've received some few number tweaks here and there. Last grab from Na'Vi being the AM, which it kind of feels like the Omnius in the air now is like kind of a knife through the heart of someone like OD. Should we be feeling that way, Scant? Is Anti-Mage like the end-all be-all against Outworld Devour? I felt like his old problems were pretty much any team that's ready to mass a BKB, and all of a sudden OD's like irrelevant at this point, and it was just better to go for options of mid laners who could segue into stronger late game. Is OD still going to be able to thrive in this one, or should he be nervous now?
I think he should be a bit nervous. I mean, the Anti-Mage pick is partly just, this is one of the Jira's main heroes when he's not playing the Lycan or the Ember. Well, this Anti-Mage is actually one of his four main heroes. But the other thing is that it is brilliant against the OD. And the only concern for Na'Vi is how it affects their lanes now, because who's going to be supporting the Anti-Mage? I kind of expected originally there would be Morana with the Bane and the Sand King and Zeus in the mid, and they're going to pick an offlaner. So does this just push the Morana into the offlane on its own? Yeah, looks like it does. Axmo picks it up, so... Well, Flame Morana, we'll have to see. I mean, the advantage of the new patch is that Morana can actually like go back and just arrow neutral creeps, kill the big ones, get some levels, maybe potentially move around the map and gank. And we might see Axmo playing as a third support more than as an actual third, like, three-position core in this game. And I think that would be totally fine. They've got plenty of damage from Anti-Mage and Zeus.
I just wonder why they might have backstepped at that point. I mean, I feel like the commitment to the Morana after already seeing the OD, it's like you laid out your supports and you're like, you know, we know OD to be a big bully in the mid lane and now we're going to bully him a bit. But now it's like they had to backstep a bit to make sure they get AM the coverage necessary in the early game. I hope that doesn't waver too much for Na'Vi. And now Fantastic Five finishing out their lineup with a Nyx Assassin here. So you get even more lockdown, which is, of course, is always necessary against the AM. He's a great combo breaker in his own right. Hell, you know, fun little nifty little thing. We have a Nyx Assassin going against the Sand King here, for example. You know, being in Vendetta, you happen to see a Sandstorming Sand King. You just simply walk in there, pop the Carapace. It will not remove your Vendetta anymore. You get the free stun there, follow up with the Vendetta Strike stun. And, well, there's a lot of just spicy interactions we should keep our eyes on in this one here, Scant. But let's get started. It's game number one of our grand final for BTS Europe. We got $10,000 of money up for grabs. First place, if I'm not mistaken, is going to be walking away with $5,000. Second place gets $3,000 here. And we're already going to have early five-man movement coming out from Fantastic Five. They could see Dit Yara, but unfortunately he's a bit too far. And I don't think they're going to be able to get the catch-up onto him. He's a bit too, mobile, so... They're going to have to let that opportunity go. And in the meantime, Scant, they'll just go ahead and drop a ward.
Yeah, he's a pretty difficult kill for them to make either way. I gotta say, actually, going back to the Marana, I'm thinking now, I'm sort of second-guessing myself that maybe all along they did plan it to be an Axumo hero because they have that early Sand King pickup for Sonika, and we know that Sonika wants to be relatively greedy. Sure, Artstyle's never had an issue being like that hard 6 position support, but I think it's nice since they have the Anti-Mage and the Zeus that both take a lot of space, and the Sand King that's probably also gonna take space, that they have an offlaner that can just like function more as an extra support and run around ganking, maybe farm some neutral creeps. So I actually think it fits very well overall for Na'Vi, and I'm just interested to see how, I mean, going back to the lanes, how's this OD going to be laning? This is not a hero that I've watched a lot in the new patch, whether it be in pubs or in competitive, and it's already been buffed twice. I don't know, like, it used to be that the arcane orb stole 0 intelligence at level 1, and then they changed to 1 and now it's 2, so...
I mean,
I don't know, is that a big deal?
I don't know, but for Fantastic Five to pull it out, I know it's only game number 1, but still Grand Finals. They're going to give it a go here. Mid lane already. Early harassment on a BZZ. Sentry war is happening at the same moment. Yol's going to intercept and help him out with a bit of frustration here. It's apparent that, you know, Zeus could be a little miffed in the lane matchup, so they wanted to kind of give him a bit of a head start here. And we'll see how much that's going to be to pay off in the long run here, but... As you're saying, you know, OD, how good is that buff? How good will it be here? I'm excited to see myself. I imagine that BZZ's got to be a big OD fan to pick it out in game number 1 here and give it a go. So we'll have to see how much trouble it's going to be for him and if Na'Vi will have to respect ban it in future games.
Well, he's tanking a lot of harassment so far, but it's just going to use up his self now. And at the start, he's not actually going for the Arcane Orb, which I think makes sense, especially against the Zeus. You're not going to get much value out of it. Start with just the Astral Spam. Of course, the Astral Spam is very different to what it used to be. It's not really about reducing the enemy hero's mana pool and then getting big hits. It's just actually to harass, really. Direct harassment deals damage.
A little trade on the bottom lane here. Dazzle trying to maintain a respective authority, but Actimo not really having any of it. Just throws an arrow right in his face and says, nah-uh. You know, I gotta remember, Marana got that old base damage buff, a little bit of attack range buff. She is not as easy to bully out from the lane, especially a single little Dazzle right now. So he's going to try to backtrack. He's going to make a camp here. He's going to try to intercept for this 2-minute rune between the both of them. He gets off a poison touch. The birds give him a little bit of trouble here. Akmo is just going to commit in for this one. Gets the arrow off, some right clicks, leaps forward, denies the invis. You're not going to get that one, buddy. I'm going for you. And now he has to head to the high ground where Sadoi's looking to intercept. Akmo heads up blindly, though, into a Blade Fury. One last poison touch, and Akmo could be the one to go down now. And it will be the first blood. And look who gets the last laugh in the end. It's the Dazzle. Fantastic Five get the first blood.
That's actually the first time I've ever seen a Fairy Fire make first blood, because that's what made the difference there. Dazzle used Fairy Fire to heal himself as he was about to die, and that's how it turns around. I mean, I've seen people survive, but I've until now I'd never seen someone like turn things around that way, so really advertising the potential value of that.
And on a support as well, it doesn't seem to be as popular, and I'm a big support player myself, and doesn't seem like one of the first items or consumables I'd be reaching out for. You know, is it always just good to have that, like, if you will, emergency pill in your pocket just in case for that factor alone? Or is it something more on top of it? I just don't see it as a popular support. I'd normally be like, oh, maybe a mango, an extra tango I could build up for. But I don't know, maybe if I got the extra 75 pence, I'll think about it a bit more.
Yeah, I think it really is. It's like he had a little bit of extra gold, decided to go for it. The mango is a bit more expensive, and also Dazzle, even with the recent like mana increase on some of the spells, I feel like this is a hero that doesn't actually have mana issues early on. It's one of the few supports that really just doesn't run out of mana because of what it's doing in lane. So why not just, you know, get the Fairy Fire? And he made it work. It worked out really well.
Looks like we already have some early movement coming out here. Now they have the vision of this. They see what Nyx Assassin's up to with that ward up on the high ground here, so a little hesitation will be coming up from Shadow.
You seen Yol's mid pulls? I thought he'd actually go for the ancient pulls, but he's just gone for the standard pre this patch pull downwards to the side.
Yeah. Oh, top rune here. Looks like we're going to have a Burrow Strike out here from Sonico, and this Nyx Assassin caught between three, looking for the high road way out, but he's going to be put asleep here from Artstyle, and boom! Gets slammed in the head. From a Thunderstrike coming out, Zeus going to be picking up that one. The game is going to be square even now. 1-1. Coming in from, a little action coming in from our stand-in now.
Yeah, Shadow doing a doing a decent job so far, and he has been denied an entire wave, well, most of a wave of XP. Some of it actually came back to the lane now. So maybe the pool not working out completely since didn't deny the entire wave.
I wonder if he mistimed. I mean, I wonder what Tusk would do, or if it's possible to connect the two camps after you're able to get the one pull in, because they're pretty damn far apart right now. And
it's definitely harder than it used to be, yeah. But I think it is possible, I would say.
I don't think it should require a second set of shards or not, but it's definitely something that if you haven't at least practiced maybe in a pub, you could easily sidestep a bit. And you're right, if you're not getting the whole wave down, you could be turning the advantage into a bit of a disadvantage in the next wave here. Arrows swinging a miss mid lane. Not going to be getting the connection there from ACMO. Just kind of stepping away from his offlane a bit. Knows it can be a bit frustrating now ever since that early skirmish, and is just trying to find a bit of action elsewhere as he shifts on through. But he'll have to do a little bit of pulls here, and it looks like a little bit of jungle farm.
Well, he's got twice of the levels that Ghostic has on the Nyx Assassin and the enemy offlane, so Mirana being able to just arrow those neutral peeps definitely working out as like a nice little backup, especially with the new neutral camp being right there at the lane, so you can always dip back into it without risking anything.
Yeah, Ghostic definitely having much more of a struggling time here. We saw him floating around that mid lane, even getting caught out. Very apparent that he wanted to also step away from his laning phase and just hope for some sort of redemption elsewhere here. Right now, at least he gets a little bit of love with the creeps coming now down under his tower, so he'll gladly take up the free XP there. But in the meantime, Na'Vi have made a hefty rotation back to his top river again, but this bounty rune is going to be easily claimed from BZZ. That rotation, though, is actually heading towards the top lane where they're going to possibly find an engagement onto the Nyx. They're looking for it here. Can they get the sleep? They can. That long range will connect. Arrow. Boom. Now Suniko going to look to shift in. Not going to need the burrow, but will use it on the dazzle. Oh, no. Tries to come in and get the save, but he is a little too late. He will go down. It's a double kill for Na'Vi. They all walk away winners in this one.
Yeah, Suniko's Sand King already showing what it's worth, and same for Axmo's Mirana, actually. It's I think I've spoken a few times in casting this team about how Axmo's introduction to the team as an offlaner has really been a good sign for them. He's been adding a lot of utility. He's made some important plays in all of their recent matches. Yesterday on the Earthshaker, like, sure, Suniko's Sand King was kind of like the one shining the most, but Axmo, you know, if Suniko hadn't been so superb, then it would have been Axmo that we were talking about.
Mid lane, this is the OD now, who seems to be bowling quite a bit. Will sidestep an arrow that was a bit unfortunate on that front. He's now stepped back. He is going Arcane Orb now. The 2-1-3 build up here. Now, I'm not going to lie, I'm not a big OD player. I wasn't in his old prime, you know, when it was the dynamic trio between him, Viper, Razor, and stuff. But is this the normal build up for your OD, or is this any sort of variance from what we used to see in the golden era?
I mean, this is completely different to what we used to see, but the Astral doesn't work the same way it used to anymore.
That's
true. I don't know, like, definitely you would have maxed the Astral before because the harassment was to, like, permanently Astral, and well, that's actually Ostal being dived at the bot lane. I think they might get it. No. Actually not going to kill him at all.
Sadoi, though, a commitment a bit too long, though, leaves him a bit behind, and he's going to need the Grave just to ensure his safe getaway, which he will get.
Looked like the heal bomb didn't bounce or something. Like, after the snowball, it looked like they wanted to heal bomb and then spin, and the heal, like, didn't actually connect, and then Juggernaut being a little bit unsure, but he's still got the Omni Slash here.
Ult to fly out, bottom lane, the back of an Omni Slash, gonna slash right through Zeus, and quickly it's Fantastic Five, who are securing a couple of kills back their way now, and even this game right back up, 3-3. Alright, so Na'Vi, they missed that opportunity to get the catch onto Jug. Tried their second roll near the rune, and it wasn't their best bet with that Omni Slash being up and ready. Was no match here. And Sadoi letting this Mirana know, hey, this is my lane now. And he's going straight for the Battle Fury buildup. So more farm intensive build coming in here for Sadoi.
Yeah, unfortunately, Ditya is obviously also going straight for the Battle Fury build. And Anti-Mage is going to farm a lot quicker than Juggernaut if they get similar timings, or especially if Anti-Mage gets slightly quicker timings. Also, Anti-Mage is a natural counter to the OD, who would probably need a BKB to fight him, but OD can't go just straight BKB on its own. I think needs one or two items before that. It's kind of like the classic dynamic of an OD. If you rush BKB and your enemies rush BKB too, then your orb's not dealing any damage to BKB, and they can still do things.
Arcel going for the long reach sleep right there. Not going to get onto little Nyx. So Nico's going to take the opportunity instead to still find some what of an economy boost in the jungle. But back at mid lane, now it is going to be Fantastic Five smoked up. They're looking for an engagement. It's going to be set up with the Astral here. Rotations are already coming, though. And Fantastic Five could back up and just happy forcing out the rotation here. It's the unfortunate perk with that long Astral setup is it also means a lot of time for a response like this one. The sleep, the arrow going to connect. And that stun is not going to be enough to slow down Na'Vi from picking off that little meal right there. Tusk will drop and Na'Vi will advance themselves forward 4-3.
So I'm interested to see the buildup of Shadow as Zeus here, because this is something Gods and I have been talking about a lot in the last week. Zeus's, the key item is really the Aetherlands these days, but a lot of the time you just feel like you need the four staff, and so you get that first and then the Aetherlands. I'm not completely sure if he'll feel the need for the four. Actually, yeah, he picks up the Staff of Wizardry, so it's going to first be the four staff. I mean, there's quite a bit of catch between the Tusk and the Nyx, so maybe just playing it safe and he'll go back for the Aetherlands a bit later on.
Yeah, I remember when the patch really first hit and Winter was staying over, one of the first heroes he picked up was the Zeus with Aetherlands, and he was going crazy over it, so I can't really blame the guy from what I'm seeing already before us with a lot of the Zeus plays. So if he does step for the Aetherlands, I couldn't really dodge the guy on that one. Back at mid lane though, Yol looking for another possible setup here onto the Zeus, currently sporting this DD rune. But bottom, we have a Midnight Shadow coming out. They got a setup on Sadoy. There's the fleet up from Soniko. The stun, the arrow is going to be a miss. So Sadoy, looking to sidestep out, gets the ward up, and Na'Vi not going to be able to get this gank. Oh, unfortunate timing right there. They're not going to catch the target.
Yeah, they didn't. They had slightly less time than they wanted to actually set up the gank. You could see they're a bit under pressure with the, like, when they used the Midnight Shadow and the Nightmare. And, well, they're just gonna smoke around and go for another kill while Axima is another one under pressure. He doesn't have leap for a few seconds and he might just die to this Omni Slash.
A lot of damage, not enough though, but they get the cleanup with the Blade Fury, a secured snowball just to be safe. Now, will the second attempt be good here in the mid lane for Na'Vi? Sleep is out, Burrow Strike, Commitment coming out from the Zeus with the ulti, and sure enough, BZZ will be taken down. So their second go will work out, and it actually ends up being a better one, taking down the core OD.
He did spend all of his gold at least, and on a Midas at that, so that's important, because OD is a hero that historically, and I think the current OD as well, it's not going to do great to farm if it doesn't have a Midas or doesn't have a good start, and it's really important that he's had a lot of CS at the start and has finished the Midas before he goes down so that he can keep up with everyone else. Because heroes, I mean, you look at Anti-Mage Zeus, even Sand King, sure, Juggernaut on his side, it's a lot of heroes that can just naturally farm the map really quickly. And it's something that you have to watch out for as early, like how does it keep up?
And all the meanwhile, a sleeping Dit-Yara getting closer and closer to this Battle Fury here. It's a race between him and this Jug, who's been a bit more fight proactive, sporting a 3-0 record, but he is still also trying to build up for what looks like his Battle Fury components here. He's a bit behind as far as net worth goes, just about 200 or so between him and this AM. Yol continues to remain off the radar, making stacks in the meantime here, trying to keep Na'Vi second-guessing a bit, but they themselves as well anticipate they need their own bit of jungle farm. Is it about time we need to get Soniko rush forward and getting something like a Blink Dagger here? That initiation does seem pretty damn crucial if they're looking to create any sort of fighting space away from this AM.
Yeah, and speaking of AM, he is 200 gold, 150 gold away from his Battle Fury. So that's, I mean, and the timer starts because Dit-Yara, quite an expert actually on this hero. He's played it a lot and he'll know which, you know, which item progression to go for depending on the situation. He'll know what the farming patterns are. And I don't know, it's not a hero that I see him making a lot of mistakes on. So I think the pressure's now immediately onto Fantastic Five as soon as they know about that Battle Fury. That sure, the one thing, they got to keep up their farm, which means Juggernaut needs to finish Battle Fury. He's also reasonably close. OD needs to make sure not to die too many times, get to the next couple of items. But it's also that they need to construct a plan around how they're going to deal with the Anti-Mage when he gets his farm. Because I don't really see Fantastic Five managing to stop the Anti-Mage farming with the heroes they have.
It's almost as if they're just preparing. Well, bottom lane, we might see a skirmish here. Artstyle going to get caught out. Omni set up from the stun from Nyx Assassin there. A good one from them gets Fantastic Five back even once more with Na'Vi at 5-5, but I think maybe Fantastic Five are already anticipating they might not be able to contest this AM and his gross amount of farm he's going to bring in, and just anticipate that once he gets fight ready, they might have to counter at that point. I mean, with the greed buildup of a Midas on OD, maybe they're hoping he'll get a sheep stick at some point with certain mobility. I don't know if that's all going to have to come from a snowball or something. And yeah, they're sweeping in here, trying to get a hold of this Nyx Assassin. So Nico with a good kill here could get him that much closer to a Blink Dagger. So they're thirsty for this one. Last hit is going to be awarded to Dityaron the tower. Now they blink in. Burrow does connect just at the tip on that one. There's going to be the Void and the kill awarded to Na'Vi. So Nico now just 100 gold away from the Blink Dagger. Sadoi shows up in lane. They're going to go for round two now. Burrow strike, arrow, commitment from Ditya, and he goes down. Whoa, and look at that KS coming out from Shadow as well. Na'Vi, a nice twofer for them.
Yeah, and it's really nice fundamentals from Na'Vi here. Like, Tsuniko with the Sand King, knowing that Sand King stun, you can actually, like, aim it to hit something slightly further ahead of where you click. So just getting that full reach on it. And then the second combination, recognizing that they could set up the arrow because the creep's going to go down. It's just really nice, you know, fundamentals of ganking being shown by Na'Vi, getting everything right, the execution working out there.
And they seem to not be letting up one bit. Now blink in hand here for Sonico certainly doesn't mean let's start pumping the brakes. He hasn't even committed yet for his epicenter here, so he still has plenty of room to grow. But before everything ended up breaking out, and I was talking about a bit of the Fantastic Five game plan, I mean, if they're trying to anticipate that this AM is going to be farming regardless and they might have ways to catch or lock them down with an OD farming up something like a, you know, a sheep stick, I was going to say, and some sort of initiation tool. And it looks like that initiation tool is going to be the old trusty force staff, which used to be a classic grab for OD. Is this a step in the right direction for them? Is it going towards that, you know, capability of locking down the AM, or will they be already way ahead of themselves and could OD be shooting himself in the foot, building up his mana pool even further?
I mean, I don't think there's a way for OD to avoid building up his mana pool, so he's going to have to go for the items he has to go for. I think basically Na'Vi will peak earlier than Fantastic Five, the way the farming game goes, and then it's about Fantastic Five just like making it over that first hill. Like if Juggernaut catches up and has a lot of farm like Anti-Mage in the late game, they could just be fine. But if Anti-Mage is one or two items ahead, and Na'Vi just capitalized during that window, it's going to be very difficult for Fantastic Five. If a big smoke gank, and they actually get the courier as a result. It had, I think, the rest of the Vlads on it. Is that right?
Yep, that's right. Vlads was on it. It was just a full smoke move coming out from Fantastic Five, migrating through the woods of Na'Vi towards the top lane, and along the way, a tantalizing little courier having to fly in front of the moving pack and feeling like they weren't going to get a whole lot else out of the smoke. They figured that was going to be their best deal, and well, now they're going to be awarded with a little bit of extra gold, and now it turns into a bit of a tower trade here. Bottom tier one in a bit of trouble here from Fantastic Five. Na'Vi will secure that one. They look to go for top, but it's taking a lot longer here for the Radiant to finish off this tier one. Na'Vi doesn't seem to be rotating and defending it. They'll take this opportunity to ward up. It looks like the Fantastic Five, you know, jungle side, and just take over the jungle altogether and continue to play the economy game while they can. Even so, Nico, look at this. Yeah, aggressively just taking the neutral camp and then bouncing out.
Artstyle continuing his pattern from, like, basically since he started playing again, not just this version of Na'Vi, the previous version of Na'Vi that Artstyle was in as well. It's just like, he never has any farm. He just doesn't take anything. He only gives to his team. And a lot of the time, like historically, teams that have a player like this benefit substantially from it, because almost every professional team has some kind of like awkward phase where they have to work out who gets how much farm. Yeah. Your four position player is getting a lot of farm. Which of your cores is getting less farm? But if you have this one completely selfless player, it just like opens up that space for everyone else.
Oh, Morana ult in the mid lane. Set up for a double burrow. Fiend's Grip going to be quickly canceled. They get the Dazzle down, Snowball rolls in, Yol gonna be going down, that's a double kill now for Shadow. Na'Vi off to the races at this point in mid lane. Doesn't seem like they're immediate to push forward for a tier one. Looks like they may kind of round up with it, but easy Morana initiation, and it seemed like Fantastic Five didn't even know it was coming. I mean, can you blame them at that point, or is it on them to kind of have a couple extra sentries on hand or just down, anticipating the Morana ulti?
Yeah, I mean, you kind of can blame them. You're playing against Mirana. It's a professional Dota game. You have to have the vision, and you see that the Tusk does pick up the sentries. It's unlikely that they'll make the same mistake again this game. That's usually what happens. But typically, it's, you know, as Mirana comes back into the metagame, people will be more and more prepared for it in each consecutive Mirana game. And it's the Mirana and the Sand King to some extent, because they're both heroes that haven't been in professional Dota for a long time. And so you're not used to, like, the way that they gank you, the style of their initiation. And it has been catching off Fantastic Five in this game for sure.
Smoked up now, Fantastic Five. Need a good win here to kind of bounce back their momentum in this game. They're going to be able to creep up and over here, possibly behind Na'Vi. This could be a huge positioning opportunity. Digirock creeps in from behind, blinks out, Snowball going to connect. They get the Walrus Punch here, and they will get awarded with the kill. Now they're going to be able to fight out with their lives. They're going to be losing their Dazzle on the run now. Fantastic Five looking to sweep back it away. OD in position, has the ulti here. But at the same moment, you have Sonico. No mana yet. He does Sol Ring, has the ulti now, and a Blink Dagger. He waits in the back pocket. Art Style baits him in. It's just going to be a Burrow Blink out. Na'Vi going to have to step back, it looks like. And Fantastic Five will be walking away with a 2-for-1 trade. That pickoff on AM, though, makes the smoke and positioning worth it to them.
Yeah, Na'Vi just really get caught out at a poor time. Because Sonico TP's in, and he can either Sol Ring and ulti and blink, or he can Sol Ring and blink and stun, but he couldn't do both. At the same time, when the anti-mage gets caught, he's like not quite paying attention, blinks to a position where the snowball still connects. It's definitely possible he could have blinked a different direction and snowball wouldn't have caught him. And lastly, there's Artstyle's Bane, who didn't have enough mana to sap and Fiend's Grip, and he had to choose between the two. So Na'Vi were just not set up to actually deal with that smoke gank, maybe not expecting it, because there had been a smoke gank just before then by Fantastic Five, shortly before when they ended up killing the courier.
Well, the double smokes. Don't see it much from a lot of the other regions, but here at the Europe CIS scene, it seems to be something they will tactically pull out from time to time, I guess, to get the upper hand advantage.
Jitura's trying to solo rush. It's going to take really long, actually.
Yeah, he gets smacked a couple extra times here. Artstyle will now kind of help him out a bit intercepting, but they quickly realize that this might be a feat too tall for them, and Digirock instead will step off in jungle. They have even a couple of stacks here built up as a side bit of farm here. Looks like Digirock will begin to work with now, but they need to make sure they kind of have the vision or help nearby. They already have a sentry in the river with a ward so they can see if Nyx is to approach under his Vendetta, which he is in right now. So
yeah, they pinged him out. They saw him at the first set of opposite sentry in the jungle over here.
We'll see it again right now too. And with him heading in there,
it's a nice improvement to Nyx, actually. That is, level 1 Vendetta has a much longer duration than it used to. I think they actually pretty much doubled it. And that's the main reason, I think, that we're seeing the hero be picked a lot more now. So you don't need the level 11 before you become, like, truly effective.
Just being able to have that kind of extra mind game where you just can stay off the radar and stay off the map that long just forces your opponents to not just play on edge. You know, it makes their item buildup suffer. You got to have the sentries, the dust possibly even on hand to deal with it. And he can be a game changer in his own right. And teams like Secret, who, you know, have players who love to utilize the Nyx Assassin, just kind of makes him that much more valuable and that, you know, look towards that much more often with these kind of buffs. So I'm happy to see it. And the late game as well with his Aghanim Scepter is very, very nice.
Yeah, it's not too long this hero was considered to be overpowered, by the way. I mean, the Impale didn't used to be a skill shot. It used to just be you could click on someone and impale them, and it made it so much easier to gank. And to me, that says, like, now that it's been, the Vendetta has been buffed and there's the Ags and all that sort of stuff, if you're really good at the Impale, then, like, this is just a better version of the previous Nyx that people said was a bit too good. So, like, a really good Nyx could actually, you know, shine in this patch, I want to say.
Uh-oh, Sadoi sees Shadow here under a sentry, gets the Omni off, but a Force and a Yules might save him for now, but no! Blade Fury will get the commitment and the kill. Ooh, wrong place, wrong time, unfortunately, and his mega kill streak will be the cost right there. Sadoi at the right place will be awarded with it and a lot of extra gold. That is just a freebie for Fantastic Five, one that Na'Vi can't afford to hand over, but is not going to make their game easier than it once was.
Na'Vi maybe looking just a little bit sloppy after a pretty healthy start to the game. a few series of events that they weren't entirely prepared for, and I don't know. It makes me wonder. Like, is it relevant that they're using a stand-in? That Dandy's not here. I don't think I've seen Shadow make any poor plays in particular, but you do get the sense that Dandy might be one of the players who's constantly like keeping the team active, saying, "Let's go here. Let's do this thing." And possibly, I mean, I don't know what Shadow's personality is like, but could be, because it feels a bit like Na'Vi stagnated really early in this game, just for like a couple of minutes. Now they're moving around, now they're trying to do some things there. They scout the rush, they go to the enemy jungle, but the last, I don't know, 5 to 7 minutes, it felt like they just allowed Fantastic Five to take the initiative.
And I don't think this is the kind of team you want to really end up snowballing out of control. If they end up peeking before you're going to be ready for it, you could be in trouble here. Arrow will hit the Roche, but they are already in trouble as an invasion of Fantastic Five members rolls through. They're going to take down Artstyle. Now they commit up to the top. But look at this Epi coming from Suniko on the back lines here from Fantastic Five. Barely alive from the grave. Nyx Assassin looking to retreat out. The Carapace is going to keep him well. He blinks away to safety. Suniko looks to invade and get the rest here, but BZZ gets hit up with a big arrow. Dityara pokes him a few times, and they quickly realize they are at a numbers disadvantage. Fantastic Five will lose nobody from this skirmish, get the two they want, and now move into the Roche and try to swipe it away from Na'Vi. Is this going to be a possible feat as Akmo will be scouting it out? A freebie arrow almost onto Roche for them, but Na'Vi letting him know that they're not happy about this. And it will go down. Picked up by Jug. Big, big momentum right now for Fantastic Five.
And it's on the back of yet another smoke that Na'Vi just didn't see coming. And they weren't grouped up. They weren't prepared. They were kind of like one of them in the enemy jungle, a few of them at a rush, like two of them standing out towards the Ancients. And like that's literally three smokes in a row for Fantastic Five. And they've all essentially connected. The first one only hit the courier, but it slowed down the anti-mage's progression a bit. The second one wins a fight, the third one wins a fight and gets the rush, so I do feel like there's a certain lack of composure from Na'Vi, like less control, less I don't know, maybe they normally have a conversation about where they want to be on the map, where each person should be, what area they try and control, and it's just not happening now. That's the sense I get.
Oh, we're seeing now, so Nico using this invis rune to get a little bit of extra intel. Too nervous to head down towards that mid lane, fearing that maybe there's a sentry up on that high ground. So instead takes his attention towards the top here and will possibly wait out on the side. It looks like he's picked up a Yules, which I imagine is good in helping out against something like the Omni Slash. But does he consider moving on and grabbing the Ags with the new Burrow Strike capability and Aether Lens? Is that the best next object for him, or should he look elsewhere?
I'll tell you, he didn't yesterday. Yesterday, I think it was the Yules and the Force Staff, and then he bought, I want to say, a Refresher. Or no, a Hex and then a Refresher. Yeah, that was, but Ditcher was actually getting caught out. And
yeah, he gets caught right in smack dab the middle of the map. Don't know how that happens, but once they catch him, he doesn't get away.
They only just barely killed him. I mean, I spoke about earlier, they don't have the right heroes to pick him off, and it kind of shows. It took the Nyx's disables, the Tusk disables, the OD LT. There's a lot of commitment, but it's worth it, absolutely, if they do catch him out. It's just like, you gotta wonder, how does the anti-mage get caught in the middle of the map by four enemy heroes? Like, what are his teammates doing? Are they making space? Are they pressuring? We saw that the Sand King and the Bane were kind of towards the top lane on their own kind of smoke gank, but because they're not split pushing the lane, you know, the pressure's not necessary. There's no reason for Fantastic Five to be there.
Woo! Jumping back burrow from Suniko. Goes into a Sandstorm, which will not get caught from the Carapace. A deep commitment Omni Slash will be mitigated from a Yules. Sadoi already committing so deep, will get the follow-up kill on the Bane. They're doing what they can while this AM is down, trying to force out his buyback, but it looks like Dityara is not going to bite. Up back and above, it looks like Suniko is going to get the catch there on the Yule. That Tusk will be going down while Sadoi continues to chop apart at this tier 3. Committing now his Blade Fury, does not want to be leaving without it. They will get it down. It will turn out. Does not force out the buyback there from Na'Vi, so it will be a small sacrifice by them. Were Fearsome 5 going to be satisfied with this one, or were they hoping to get a bit more from the push?
No, I think they'll be fine with it. I mean, sure, they lost their Tusk, they got the Bane, they got the Tower. I think you're right, they would have loved to get a buyback, but you know, it's not the end of the world. The game is actually progressing really well for them at this point. They've, if you look at the gold graph, it kind of tells the story. They were going behind, and then suddenly the sharp turn, and they've just not looked back since then. And it's literally when they started smoking. Their smokes have worked. Na'Vi's smokes have not worked. And Odie's Midas has really paid off, heading towards that hex now. And I do feel like if Odie gets that hex completed in the next few minutes, which seems likely, he's just like about 1,000 gold away, that could spell the end for Na'Vi, like, quite suddenly.
I mean, there's always that factor, caught out without a BKB, all this mana, very low, could be a nuclear bomb for his own team in the right hands of Dityarov, but based on this mid-game performance from Na'Vi and what kind of coordination they've shown so far, I don't know if the opportunity will show itself, but Art Style, the man left behind, it looks like here, will be taking down Walrus Punch. He's keeping him, he's making him work for it. Finally, he will go down. And Na'Vi, who were just kind of invading, getting some wards down themselves, any extra intel to see the Fantastic Five movement so they can stall out maybe in hopes that this AM could still be a late-game tirade. Those seem to be, I don't know, not as plausible at this point. It's now quickly turning into an AM on the run than an AM who's just kind of finding most of the farm and is going to be lurking in the dark.
And Na'Vi consistently just in this game, they don't look sure about what they want to do. Does Anti-Mage want to be split pushing, pressuring lanes on his own? Does the Sand King and Bane want to be looking for ganks? Does the Mirana want to be looking for ganks? They end up, I mean, they seem to be exploring so many different approaches to the game at once that they end up on different pages a lot of the time, or spread out unnecessarily, and then Fantastic Five run into them, grouped up, and punish them every single time. And maybe again, yeah, Axmo gets caught. He does leap away, but I think this, yeah, Tusk does connect.
Oh, but they get the assistance from Suniko, but that Omni says, no. And they're going to get the quick takedown of Mirana. Will the push commitment come out here from Fantastic Five with the numbers advantage? Mirana on the sidelines, 40 seconds, no buyback for her. Fantastic Five ascend themselves into the high ground. Mild split pressure from Na'Vi at the bottom lane, but it's time to possibly fight for them or risk losing Arrakis already. Just game number one of this grand final. Fantastic Five, a team that only Cyclops has been able to cast and follow up to this point to their grand final journey, and looking to make a big upset here against the highly touted, big name Na'Vi group.
Yeah, and it's Ditchera has finished his BKB now on the Anti-Mage. That might be like the key item because it basically makes you immune to OD. So if Juggernaut wastes his Omni Slash and then Anti-Mage goes in with the BKB, he can sort of do whatever the hell he wants. And put that team that up with Suniko hitting a nice, you know, multiple hero Barrow Strike. All of a sudden Na'Vi could take a big fight. Just off the fact that Ditchera has picked up this BKB. But maybe, I don't know, maybe Sadoi is going to be wise to that and he's going to just hold on to his Omni Slash for if the Anti-Mage commits. Or just not even his Omni Slash, just his right clicks. He's got his own BKB. He can easily deal with the Anti-Mage in BKB, but I don't think anyone else in his team can. Well, Odie's X, actually, if they catch the Anti-Mage before BKB, that's a pretty good recipe for ending the game, too.
I wonder now if they need to get some backup assistance for his AM in the item department. Oh, so Nico is just a man who's got the thirst, but he was so close yet so far from catching out a precious little Dazzle, and only Dazzle may not know how close it was indeed. But he's got a lot of gold saved up, near 4K here for Sand King. Is he planning on getting something like a Lotus Orb to help out this AM, or is he investing all the way in for a Sheepstick with this much money?
Yeah, it was yesterday his build was Sheepstick. That was, I mean, there was a 4-star somewhere in between, but his first big, really big item was a Sheepstick, and it kind of makes sense because he likes to be able to be that controlling Sand King. The hero's like about stunning things. It's not, I mean, the LT is like a bonus when you get it off. It's really about controlling, and that's what I really liked so much about that play that everyone was talking about yesterday, because he didn't even use Epicenter there. It was just about getting important stuns, and the Hex just kind of extends that. You're a control hero.
Both tier 2s going down. The top there for Fantastic Five, bottom will be claimed but by Na'Vi. Na'Vi will be first to rotate back to this top lane in a bit of defense, and we seem to be a bit of a wash here between both teams. I mean, would you feel that way, Scant? I mean, almost smack dab down the middle, and next Roche could kind of give that next team a bit of advantage, or do you feel like Fantastic Five have the slight upper hand with the damage they've already done in the mid lane.
Double damage.
Or not. Maybe Scant not there at the moment, but we'll see a Vendetta.
Oh, can you hear me?
Oh yeah, hello, welcome back. Sorry.
Okay, I was talking to myself. There's like a mute button on my microphone that sometimes just doesn't work. So I like mute myself, unmute, and it just doesn't unmute, and it's pretty annoying. But anyway, I was actually saying that I think that Fantastic Five do have quite a significant upper hand. And it's not just that they've got the one Nidorax, it's the OD's Hex. It's just that much more punishing, I feel like. Like, there's so many heroes on Fantastic Five. They're usually grouped up, and there's a lot of heroes that could catch you out if you go too close to that hero in particular. The Juggernaut's now got a Basher as well, and when he finishes Abyssal Blade, it'll kind of be like four of the heroes. Everyone except for Dazzle can, like, initiate on you, catch you out if you go too close to them, and that's worrying. I mean, Na'Vi could take a big fight, and if they do, they could be ahead, but we haven't seen it happen yet.
Roche will be taken from Fantastic Five. They make a ballsy jump commitment in here to grab Artstyle. They will get a hold of him. They spot out the Mirana ulti, and the rest of Na'Vi, though, have already accepted that the Roche was not going to be swiped or taken any sort of way and have added the pressure elsewhere here. Dit-Yara going pretty heavy in this mid lane right now, trying to do some work on this tier 2 while, you know, Shadow was pushing out that bottom lane as best as he could. Dit-Yara will kind of retreat out, but again, Fantastic Five will claim an Aegis here, and kind of how they want to dictate the pace of this game, utilizing this Aegis to maybe make another go at a different lane. I mean, you still have a tier 2 to close out in this bottom lane.
Oh, anti-mage.
AM, though, almost caught out here. Sudoi makes a commitment in. BKB going to be Papa, and D-Ra is going to be walking away. So Nico scouted out. Weave does see him. They get him. All right.
And that was a... Dit-Yara would die if there's an Abyssal Blade up there, because he blinked in front of them, and so that's why Sudoi was like, okay, I can just blink after you and go on you, and he just hopes that the Omni Slash will get enough bashes to hold him in place. It unfortunately didn't, but if he has the Abyssal Blade, it's a very easy kill, and that's kind of what I was referring to before. I really worry for Na'Vi here. I think their chances are slipping very, very, very quickly, and I don't know if you saw, but that's actually a Shadow Blade on Nico. That's an interesting approach. I talked to Gods yesterday about how, like, sometimes the Shadow Blade is really that much more value in the super late game because people aren't prepared. Well, there's a Fiend's Grip at the top lane.
They glimmered him up in helps, but Dit-Yara'd is able to kind of boot himself in and get to the hustle here. But BZZ is going to finish off Bane. Grave's going to keep OD alive for now. Puts his pressure onto Dit-Yara, but eventually the Grave will end and so will the Aegis. And quickly, Na'Vi will just have to take that winning and walk on out of there.
He tried to Astro himself, very nearly got it off. If he had gotten it off, he probably wouldn't have even lost the Aegis. And Sunico on the other side, using that Shadow Blade, just running straight out of the base looking for something, but they're not there. They're pushing your base to the top lane.
Arrow out, obviously. Gonna catch on that creep, take it down. Sudoi eating a lot of damage early. We healed up a bit. Muscling back Na'Vi. Bane, the only one down, is soon to be up here. And we'll see if Na'Vi are going to be able to hold, but that Aegis not in the hands anymore of the Fantastic Five, so they have to be a bit more hesitant with their commitments here. And it looks like once all five from Na'Vi are up, they don't want to bother risking any sort of advantage they've already gotten for themselves, so they pull off for now. We'll take away the Na'Vi jungle. Happy to just kind of force AM to reach out that much further to find his own bit of farm. It looks like both him and Sonico are heading all the way towards the bottom lane, which is pretty far pushed right now, while Fantastic Five are going to round things out towards this mid lane and just kind of keep the pressure alive between these two lanes. But eventually, they're going to need to back up and address this bottom lane if Na'Vi are to push it.
And I'm just looking at Artstyle's net worth. It's kind of funny. I mean, we spoke about how he's like sixth position, but it's been going down. He had 1,500 net worth a few minutes ago. I wanted to make a point about it. Yesterday, actually, for like one of the entire games, apparently the chat was just spamming leave Artstyle alone because he's just always in this position. He's seven times poorer than the next poorest person in the game. He has brown boots. That's pretty much all he has. So, like, the fact that he got like most of the Fiend's Grip off at the top lane was pretty ridiculous, actually.
Oh,
like,
they spotted Sonico here. Oh, and he is gonna get caught out. Yol just snipes him right away.
Sonico's not having his game either. I mean, yesterday he had possibly the best ranking performance I've ever seen in my life, and today they're one step ahead of him every single time. They've caught him out a few times now.
Dazzle is alone in mid lane here. He's just trying to mid push and he's dead. I don't know what that was. He maybe a scouting report for the rest of his team. He was just trying to lone push, caught out now, and well, maybe that scouting report could reward them with something. Mid lane, Omni out on a Ditya Raz, gonna force up the BKB and a retreat by him, while Yol was able to kind of bully back this Bane into their base. But here comes Fantastic Five now, maybe attempting to finish off this Rax mid lane, but they can't do it.
It's a bit weird. I mean, Dazzle shouldn't be on his own. Zedoi probably shouldn't be Omni slashing there. A lot of the plays being made by Fantastic Five here, to me, they suggest that they've decided they've won the game and they're getting a bit complacent. They're like, okay, we can just, can we just end already, guys? You know, and it is often, I don't know what your experience, but I feel like it is often a support player that's like, we should be able to win the game right now, but like these idiots just want to keep farming. Okay, fine, I'll just go there and hopefully they'll come with me. Maybe that's what the Dazzle was doing, but hopefully for their sake, they can, you know, maintain the composure, because this game is like definitely not out of reach for Na'Vi.
Yeah.
And if instead of feeding a Dazzle, they feed like an entire team, suddenly Na'Vi are winning.
I mean, now you have a Ditya Ra butterfly AM here, and there's not a lot of answers for it. Ditya Ra commits on in, pops the Manta, forces out BZZ with his BKB, and he is hustling out, gets the Glimmer. Oh, Sonico swinging a miss with the Burrow. Walrus Punch committed onto one of the illusions here. Yules helps avoid the arrow, it looks like. Ditya grows in, gets the Mana Void off onto Tusk. They're going to finish him off. Dazzle very low, might need to stay and get the Grave off, will do so. Epicenter's out, they're going to get the finish onto Dazzle and take down the OD, and right on the marker you're talking about, Fantastic Five shouldn't get too comfortable. Na'Vi are able to clean out three, but look at this. Bottom lane, they sweep right into the base. And they're going to be going right for this tier 3.
There's an Omni Slash. There's a Blink Omni Slash. I wonder if he goes for Zeus.
No.
I guess Zeus stores the Yules and the Force stuff, so he decides not to. But that's actually right before, I think Na'Vi, the reason they start the fight there is because they saw Zedoi actually TP to the bot lane, start pushing, and so he couldn't get back there even if he wanted to. And it's almost the reverse of the dynamic we saw during the mid game, where Na'Vi looks spread out on the map, not really sure what they want to do, got punished for it over and over. I feel like that's what they just did to Fantastic Five. The one big deal is that out of that, Fantastic Five get a tower kill, they get some chip damage in the base, and Zedoi does finish his Abyssal Blade. It does also mean that he doesn't have buyback if he were to die in the next fight, but there's been a number of times that he's Omni slashed the Anti-Mage, I think 3 or 4 times now, and the Anti-Mage eventually just blinks away.
Yeah.
And if he has the Abyssal Blade, that's not happening.
Yeah, he stepped off in the meantime to get the boot to travel, got the knife now. So this could be the peaking window for Fantastic Five. One more strong fight in, they could close this game out. There's still buybacks to work through here on the AM, but uh-oh, Arstyle's down. I mean, he's a paperweight at this point, but they go for a bigger target here into ACMO. The Abyssal was committed for it. She gets the leap off. The Morana ult's going to be used defensively here as a retreat. And that is all she wrote. Na'Vi are going to just lose their support. At this point, losing Bane, though, isn't really a big loss, so they'll take it for what it's worth. Dazzle could be the response here, though. Again, far out on his own. Oh, Burrow going to catch him here. And it could be this is just sad. Now Ditya Ra is like, get over here. Get over here. You can try to Grave, but eventually he will Glimmer and possibly walk away. Oh, no, he will not. He goes down. Sand King will pick it up with the Sandstorm, though.
They had to actually use the Zeus ulti there. I was wondering why he didn't just Glimmer earlier, because they didn't have any reveal. But Zeus ulti just to make sure that they see him and finish up the kill.
Ooh.
Well, speaking of Zeus, he's actually been scouted out, and just as he reveals the Nyx on him, Nyx actually initiates. Does Odie get the Hex off? No, Zeus forces away just on time.
And the sleep also narrowly not there from the Bane, where he canceled it out. And Na'Vi will kind of step back and reposition themselves, knowing that Fantastic Five could be nearby, waiting for a battle of their own, which they were. They'll step off, go right back into the jungle front here, and we're looking at Fantastic Five still controlling the economy game just by a little bit. Na'Vi now smoked up. Roche is up here, and Ditya Ra goes to work on it, but Fantastic Five, they're all huddled up right now. They even have this Nyx burrowed up on the high ground here, but they might need to eventually just kind of scout on in there. It looks like Yol's going to be the one to do so. Immediate jump in. Walrus punch Akmo out already. Dityarod, the response is going to go into Sodoy. Sodoy, he's bashed up. Can't make it out. It's going to be forced to Omni. And the quick retreat out from Dityarod, seeing that BZZ has showed up. They've already taken out two from Na'Vi. Shadow goes down. Dityarod may have a mana void, but there's not going to be an easy target for them, and he just has to walk away. Fantastic Five to sweep in, take over the Roche for themselves now. And this could be disaster for Na'Vi soon. OD's going to be picking up this Aegis, and we'll have to see what Na'Vi can do to respond to the soon-to-come high ground push.
Yeah, well, looks like Sneaker's actually looking to scout out to maybe cut the wave. He could go down, actually. The Nyx is really close to him. Yeah, Ghostick's going to turn around and just barely misses the pink.
But get some work on the creep wave. The creeps will still be able to make it through. And we'll see if Fantastic Five will have a window to kind of move in with these creeps and finish off at least what they started in the mid lane. But Na'Vi not out for long. Zeus still has buyback, otherwise has 10 seconds, which I'm sure he's going to be waiting out. So Nico's still kind of up to some sneaky behavior behind Fantastic Five, but they have rotated now to the bottom lane here. It looks like they're going to be going for a tier 3, which is now dropped. Now we have a burrowed Nyx Assassin on the watch. Artstyle tries to go for a Fiend's Grip, but there's that burrow, a long one at that, or the Impale coming out from the Nyx, going to get the finish on that. So Nico, respectable burrow forward here. BZZ, without a BKB, just tries to muscle him down. We'll get the double kill. Turn back for Dityarod, who will be able to blink out from the trouble. But now the buyback comes out from Sonico. Rax is exposed. They go to work. Commitment in. There comes the Epi. Big work from Sonico here, but the follow-up going to be coming in here from Fantastic Five. It's going to be an easy wipe from them. Akmo to go down. Lone Survivor in this Dityarod AM in just a moment, who barely slips away the left-hand side. Attention back on the racks once more from Fantastic Five. It looks like game one should be theirs momentarily. Na'Vi had a promising start in even early mid game, but things seem to kind of fizzle away from them.
Yeah, BZZ actually cut a court a few times. It's something I noticed about his OD this game, not using a lot of offensive force stuff. So I wonder if Artizzi's watching somewhere maybe disappointed because he kind of made the hero famous, the forcing in blindly and initiating on people. But, I mean, the conservative approach actually works for them here. The Fantastic Five just, like, played together as a group. They had a clear plan. They walked around the map almost always with purpose. It was the one time they split up and it was maybe a bit of a mistake. They got punished for it. But on the most part, they looked much more on top of their game than Na'Vi. Much more, like, with a clear purpose and plan in mind. And I think that's what wins them the game, ultimately.
And that's going to conclude game number one. Fantastic Five will get the victory here on the back of the Sodoy 11-1 jug. An all-around solid performance by them. And, well, an OD gets a win, one we don't get to see very often in that. So stick around. It's just a best of five grand final performance. This is Coddle Guy for Beyond the Summit. I'm here with Scant, of course. We'll cut to a few minutes of a break. And when we return, it's going to be game number two of Na'Vi versus Fantastic Five. We'll see you soon.